this beautiful evening, we shall see one more drop of this Leela Samudra, the ocean of Leelas, the divine play. In all this Leela, though it appears as though people want only worldly things, and only those things are given by the Lord. Every time we ask for something, feeling the need for it, and we intensify His Nama, He comes to our rescue immediately, and whatever we want gets achieved. But at the same time, the intensity with which, the desperation with which we chant the name will deepen His imprint upon the fabric of the soul. So it is not just Leela, giving all worldly things alone. It's also very quietly transforming from the depths of the being. That's one of the reasons why we people have to remember again and again the Leelas. Like they remember the Leelas of Rama, the Leelas of Krishna. It's a sadhana. Every remembrance of any Leela, any event connected with the Lord will bring down a pour of blessings. Now today, we shall see how Bhagwan Yoginathrakma, in those days, when there was no place at all for him to stay, he had to stay under the Punai tree, and sometimes he would stay in the chariot mandap. Many times he would be seen just opposite the old bus stand. And of course, the night, after the vessel shops had closed, he would be sleeping in the planks, open to all kinds of threats and dangers. He suffered from the police also, as much as he suffered from the miscreants. That was the main reason why he shifted to the Sanadhi Street house at all. He was a man of nature. He preferred very much staying under the tree and moving around freely. But the difficulties he had to face with people forced him to take up a roof, a house like Sanadhi Street. Now before that, whenever there was a heavy rain or oppressive sun, he took shelter under the tomb of a Shiva Bhakta. His name was Subbaya Nada. He was originally from Tuticorin, where he was a merchant. But he lived a very virtuous life. He and his wife together served the devotees of God. And soon after some time, they Subayanada, he found that he had to come to Thiruvannamalai and serve the Shiva Bhaktas here. He took up sannyas and then he shifted his place to Thiruvannamalai. He started to serve. Such was his devotion that he would not wear chappals. He would not wear slippers when he walked anywhere in Thiruvannamalai because it was the land of Shiva, the holy land of Shiva. So he would not wear slippers. He was serving the sadhus of Thiruvannamalai. He would feed them very well and he would serve them in any way was needed. When he passed away, his descendants built a samadhi there on the Girivalam path, the mountain path, a little beyond the old bus stand. Swami was very fond of going there because he had often taken shelter under the roof of the samadhi from heavy rain, like I said, oppressive sun. So when his people, the descendants of Sri Subayanada and Annamma was his wife's name, they would come to this mutt every year during the Deepa celebrations. It's called a Deepotsavam. And they would come every year and stay here for 10 days, 12 days. And after the Deepam, they would all go back. At that time, Swami also would go there, spend a lot of time with them. There's a hall, the first story, and that is where he would meet people. And there would be quite a celebration of satsang there with Bhagwan's vibrant presence. They were all very devoted to Bhagwan. And what was more, the 76th Jayanti, in the year 1976, Jayanti of Bhagwan Yogi Ram Sutma was celebrated there. 77th Jayanti was also celebrated there. And it is from there, once when Sri Arunachaleshwara was coming in procession in the streets of Thiruvannamalai, when he came near Subayanada Mutt, Swami came down with great speed, had darshan of Arunachaleshwara and went back as speedily as he came. And in so doing, with one sweep of his hand, he pushed away a blind man who was standing in his path. And people were shocked. They all thought, how could this man, if people call him a saint, do this to a blind man? But Bhagwan didn't even look back. He just went up. But the man began to shout with joy, extreme joy. He said, oh, I could see now. Who is it who touched me just now? Who pushed me? It is none other than Arunachaleshwara himself. He has given me back my sight. Now I am able to see everywhere. I am able to see Arunachaleshwara. But where is the one? Arunachaleshwara who gave me my sight. And that's when people realized that this God-man's touch was magic, pure magic. One sweep of his hand, he brought sight to a blind man, did not even look around to see that. So once Yogi Ramchandra Kumar Bhagwan, when he was there in Subbayanadar Mutt. Subbayanadar, the daughter on Champakam Amman, also a great Shiva devotee, Shiva Bhakti. And her granddaughter, Meenakshi, was only a school girl at that time. She was also very fond of Bhagwan, very devoted to Bhagwan. She would come running every time when the elders came. She would insist on coming with them. And of course, Swami was pouring his love and grace upon all those people there. So once, when she came to the hall of Subbayanadar Mutt, Swami said, Yogi Ramchandra Kumar Bhagwan said to this little girl, Shivaya Namo, Shivaya Namaha. He gave this mantra to her and asked her to repeat it. So she stood there and started chanting, and she would chant first and people there would follow her. This went on for 2 hours. The girl did not feel tired. She felt very excited, in fact, because Bhagwan had asked her to do that. And Bhagwan was also sitting, blessing people there. After 2 hours, Bhagwan lay down. But the girl went on and on. She was standing for 2 hours already, and now she went on, even though Bhagwan seemed to be asleep. After some time, it was nearly 3 hours, the elders around began to think, what is this, the slip of this girl standing there chanting loudly, and now it's going to be 3 hours she has been standing and chanting and chanting. So they were trying to gesture to her to stop it. Swami was sleeping, why don't you stop? But the girl would not stop. Bhagavan had asked her to chant the name, so she went on and on and on. And then when these people, elders, began to pressurize her, she looked at her mother, Uma Surendran. Her mother had closed her eyes, and she was also doing this Nama chant. And so she would not stop. Meenakshi would not stop. She could not stop. She went on. At the end of 3 hours, she had a very curious experience, a beautiful experience. Suddenly, it was no more her voice, another voice took over. And this voice was singing the Nama. She thought it was very funny. She began to watch this, because it was fun for her in the beginning. But after that, when she suddenly thought it was some other voice from inside her chanting the name, she got frightened. As soon as she got frightened, Swami woke up and said, Poduma, Amma, you stop. It's enough. Enough, stop. And later, this girl asked her mother, Ma, why is it some other voice was singing? Her mother said, it's only his voice, because you've been singing loudly for so long, and he wanted to help you, so he took over, he could do anything. And she became very, very happy hearing that. Another time, every year, Bhagwan used to go there and watch the Deepam from there, from Subbayanadar Mutt. But once he came up to there and met Meenakshi's father and said, this time, this beggar is going to watch the lighting at the peak of the hill inside Arunachalishvara Mandir. This beggar is going to the Mandir, the temple. And then Swami said, two people could come with him. And there were two passes. Without pass, you cannot enter because lakhs and lakhs of people would visit and participate in this Deepa function. And so Swami said, okay, the father's name Surendra. Surendra, you can come with me. And then who will come? Who else will come? Her father said, my daughter Meenakshi will come. So Meenakshi also accompanied him. Swami started to walk very fast. When they entered the temple and started walking on the floor of the temple, they went to the outer corridor. The floor was all granite stone. And it was about 1:30 afternoon. The sun was shining brilliantly and the heat was terrible, unbearable. And Swami was walking very fast and this girl had to run after him. And she felt the heat so much, she could not put her foot down at all. She had to run. Anyway, she managed running behind him and finally Bhagwan reached a certain place and sat there. And down there on the floor, it was very, very hot. But he just sat there, so these people also had to sit with him. Then Bhagwan said to Meenakshi, you start chanting Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala. So Meenakshi started, and Bhagwan once again began to lay down. Now her father was sitting on the other side, on the head side, and he was fanning Swami, and both of them felt the heat penetrating from the floor. It occupied their legs and then the thighs, and it was ascending to the hips. It was burning. And they could not get up and walk away because Bhagwan was lying down there. And Bhagwan had asked them to sing the name. So they had to go on. But very soon, they felt that there was no heat. The heat began to reduce. And finally, there was no more heat. The heat that was burning them. They just wanted to run away from the place, but still they could not do it because Bhagwan was present. And this burning heat, somehow, as she continued chanting the name, bearing with it, it began to reduce, and finally, there was no heat at all. It was still very hot. The sun was up there and very oppressively, and it was burning hot, and still they did not feel any heat. She went on and on from 2:30, nearly 4:30, up to 4:30. She was singing. About 5 o'clock, Bhagwan got up and joined. When Bhagwan was lying down, it was not as though he was asleep. I had seen Bhagwan lying down and doing tremendous cosmic work at different levels at a time. I cannot talk about all that, but his sleep is no sleep. It's a sleep of intense activity, cosmic activity. 5 o'clock, he got up visibly, and then he also joined the chanting, Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva. At 6 o'clock, they all together watched the lamp being lighted there on top of the hill. Another time, Sri Gajaraji visited him at Sanadi Street House at that time. About 5:30, 5:45, Swami sent away all those visitors except Sri Gajaraji. And then both of them went up to the terrace, and from there they watched the Deepam on the hill. And this time Bhagwan gazed and gazed. When he turned to Shri Gajaraji, Bhagwan's eyes were full of tears. Tears were streaming down, and he said to Gajaraji, "Gajaraji, you see Lord Shiva there? Lord Shiva is there." And tears were streaming down. Another time, when Gajaraji, it was his 60th birthday, had come to spend the time with Bhagwan, and Bhagwan agreed surprisingly because he wouldn't do it easily. And they all went to, Bhagwan said he would also join them. So all of them, some 25 people from his family, Shri Gajaraj family and Bhagwan, they went inside the Sanctum Sanctorum of Lord Arunachala. And then the Abhishekam started, 25 people, and they were all singing Arunachala Shiva, Arunachala Shiva, Yogi Ram. And when the Abhishekam was going on, the crowd outside, crowds and crowds of them, they're all watching this Abhishekam with folded hands. Here, Yogi Ram Sarath Kumar turned towards the people, raised both his hands, and was blessing and blessing until the Abhishekam was over. Arunachala was being worshipped. The Abhishekam was being done to Lord Arunachala, to the Linga there. But Swami turned towards people, raised both his hands, and blessed, was blessing, blessing, blessing for quite some time, revealing his true identity as Arunachaleshwara. I'm just giving this as glimpses, like how Bhagwan acted the same occasion in different ways. When we look at Meenakshi's episode of running behind Bhagwan in that hot sun when the floor was burning, and then he lay down, she was chanting, and then they felt the heat, burning heat, for some time. I thought it was very symbolic of our life. In the hot sun, our samsara, our life on the earth, full of problems, one problem or the other. Very few people are fortunate. They have only small, small problems. Many people have to suffer. But even in our suffering, Bhagwan is walking with us. Even as Meenakshi was running the hot floor, Bhagwan was walking in the front. He was also walking with her, but still it was burning hot and she had to face it. And then after they reached a place, when Bhagwan sat there again, she also had to sit down. And when she sat down, the heat began to penetrate. It was burning her legs, thigh, her hips. It was ascending. She could no more sit. But she continued singing because Bhagwan had asked her. So when we have these burning problems in our life, a suffering which burns like fire, if we still continue chanting the name as Meenakshi did with determination, just because Bhagwan had asked her, she was an anger. Bhagwan had asked her, and therefore she had to go on singing no matter what, no matter how burning it was. If we do that, like she felt, afterwards, the heat began to reduce. And finally, there was no more heat. Same thing would happen with all those problems that are attacking us in life with great force and heat. would become less and less problem, and finally we wouldn't be able to feel the force of the problem. The intensity would reduce and finally will be no more. And after that part, Bhagwan began to sing with her. So at one point you would begin to feel Bhagwan's presence vibrantly. And you would see him accompanying wherever you go, whatever you face. And after that, we would get Deepa Darshanam, which is symbolic of our Atma Darshanam. You would see the Supreme God inside, the formless, the all-pervasive, all-knowing, all-powerful, supreme. As the light of the soul inside.